Today we're up in North London at the notorious bikers venue, the Ace Cafe. And we're here to meet a notorious punk. His name is Dave Vanian, singer of The Damned. Maybe not the first guy you would imagine that would be into bikes, too much makeup, but this guy has got a passion for everything vintage, including his 1945 Harley Davidson. He's a punk icon, he's been a lifelong classic biker, and he is, of course, the godfather of the goths. Let's go meet Dave Vanian.
I got a feeling inside of me. It's kind of strange, like a stormy sea. I don't know why, I don't know why. I guess these things have got to be. I've got a new rose, I've got a good. Guess I knew that I always would. I can't stop to mess around.
So here we are, we're up at the Ace Cafe. I'm sitting right next to Dave Vanian, obviously legendary singer with The Damned. Dave, I guess we're at your favourite spot in NW10 in London, aren't we?
Yeah, it's a nice spot to drop in, open all hours, get a cup of cappuccino, great. Mm.
Do you mind if I talk to you about back in the early days?
Right, I set them off. No, that's okay, fire away.
Yeah, no, I'm sure it was a period, like, for many people like myself, it's completely revolutionised their life, you know. It must have felt like that you were at the epicentre of something that was so special at the time.
It was, except I think when you're actually involved in it at that point, it was going so fast and so quickly that you failed to see what was really happening. I think when people step back and look at it and say, oh, that's what was happening, but at the time you were just playing gigs, you didn't know if the band were going to stay together, and everything was very small and concentrated.
I've got to hear this story today, Dave. I know that it was as a consequence of Sid Vicious screwing up, basically, that you got the job as singer in The Damned.
I don't know if it was screwing up, he probably just didn't get out of bed or something. But yeah, I was asked to go and audition. Brian James, I met him in a club in the Nashville Rooms, I think, and he said, come down and sing. I said, what time? And he said, blah, blah, we've got to see somebody else. So I thought, I'll turn up half an hour earlier, see who the competition is. So I got down there, and they're in this old church hall with this gay vicar running around saying, can you not play so loud and all this stuff that they got the time for. And he never turned up, and I got the job. I don't know if I got the job because I was the best choice, whether I was there.
Can you remember some of your favourite anecdotes from that period when the band were first playing and the whole punk scene was first exploding and literally changing people's lives?
Well, when it first started, nobody, obviously it didn't have a name. Mm. And everybody hated you. Everybody. You know, we played a gig, and as we were playing, they pulled the curtains on us, thinking that we'd just stop playing. And people were walking out, and then we just poked our heads through the curtains and kept going. They just didn't know what it was about. You know, they couldn't understand it. And Captain used to drive a lot of people out, because he had a thing against people with beards.
Did he really?
Yeah. Anyone with a beard can leave now, and so that's half the audience with him.
Still galvanises The Damned today, because I mean, obviously the scene was so explosive, wasn't it? You know, it blew up and burnt so brightly and then pretty much disintegrated, and yet The Damned are still together and playing and probably stronger than ever in spite of your little foibles across the years.
It sounds old-fashioned, but for us it was always about the music. You know, we had a great... The thing is, we were probably one of the most honest bands at that period, because we didn't have a political agenda, even though we're politically separately. Our idea was to go and make good music and actually enjoy it and have the audience enjoy it. And then put a few messages in that were there, wherever you saw them. You know, right from that first album right through to now, we've experimented on every album. We never had the massive success that kind of can blow you right out of the water and sort of you become this huge ego. We've always been, we still are, unfortunately, a bit broken hungry. And eager, you know, so in fact we're probably worse now because we're gnarly old men that are like that, so we're really vicious, you know.
So let's talk a little bit about the bike that we're going to see today, this beautiful Harley Davidson, 1945. Where did you pick it up?
Well, I bought it from a chap up north about 10 years ago, and he rescued it off of somebody who was going to chop it to pieces, basically, and I don't know, build some raked-out bike with it. I don't even know how much of the original bike would have been left. It's a comfortable bike, and it's a simple bike to work on. But it's not a bike you can really go that fast on. It's a 750, but flatheads are not really renowned for burnouts. You know, but I like it.
Right, come on, let's go and have a look at this bike here, shall we? Come on.
Okay.
Oh, Dave, what a gorgeous, gorgeous motorcycle this is. Quite extraordinary as well. Do you want to talk us through some of the functions? I see, is this a gear stick here?
Yeah, that's the gear shift lever, which is three gears. This is a foot clutch, like a car clutch, basically.
Yeah.
That you rock. That holds in position when you change the gear. But essentially, the bike is a wartime issue bike, which would have all been drab green. But this has been civilianised with some paint.
Unbelievably low slung at the bottom as well there. I mean, how do you cope with the speed bumps in London? Don't you get stuck in the middle?
Speed bumps are okay. Yeah, it's just you can't really lean over too far though. But originally that would have been even lower because as an army bike from here back to here would be a steel plate, which was an armour plate. So the guy could get his bike, lean it over and drop it down, pull out his Thompson machine gun or machine gun that was in the scabbard here and shoot over the top of the bike
really?
At the enemy. I don't know if anybody ever actually did that, but they were trained to do that.
Now the tank is split, right? There's petrol in this side and oil in the other.
That's right, yeah.
Show us the little dipstick in there. It's such a little
trick. Oh, I see my little dipstick there. There we go. Hopefully plenty of oil in there. There you go. Nice and black too.
I want you to tell me a little bit about one of my favourite details on this bike.
No.
You know, these beautiful little dice just there.
Well, Harley Davidson would sell these aftermarket things. And there was an amazing amount of things which were lucky charms. They'd have like half a dozen different coloured rabbit's feet and things like that. And little dice for on here. And it was, I think it was, you know, you had to be lucky to keep going on the things. It was getting through their journeys, these things. So it's essentially quite simple, but you know, it's also a very forgiving machine. If you don't get everything just so, it'll still run, you know.
Really? Yeah.
Yeah, maybe not well, but it'll run.
Right, let's have a bit of a chat about the bike stuff. So what happened when you were 16? Did you just kind of have that lust for freedom that all of us do and think, I've got to buy a moped, this is the way forward?
My first, well, the bike I had to get because I didn't have it, although I'd ridden back when I was a kid, I had no license, so I had to buy an MZ.
Oh.
And I actually didn't mind it. I thought, well, it's kind of like a BSA 125 almost, you know.
Yeah.
Everyone hates them.
My dad used to have an MZ. It nearly broke my ankle every time I tried to start it, actually.
Oh, yeah?
It's got that fierce kick, hasn't
yeah.
it?
Yeah.
And obviously, I mean, there's a beautiful Harley Davidson parked outside, the 1945 Classic.
I mean,
tell us the steps that you made in between. Were there other bikes that came?
Yeah, I had a couple of Sportsters and a Triumph Daytona, 68 Daytona. I loved that bike, but it needed so much work. I spent 2 years going around auto jumbles, sourcing parts for it, you know.
Yeah. People always ask me a question that I'm going to ask you, actually. If you had to choose, would it be music or motorcycles?
Well, if I could make a living off motorcycles, it would be motorcycles, funnily enough.
Really?
Now it would be, yeah. Because that's a tough one. Yeah, I think if I could have made money at an old bike shop, I would have done.
There's a revelation. Wow.
Yeah.
Right then, Dave, I reckon we should take a bit of a run out to Watford. I've got a mate over there who's got some brand new Harleys, and I want you to come and have a look at them, see how they stack up against your vintage bike. Are you up for that?
All right, I'm up for it, yeah.
Okay.
I'll take you down to Bill Price's London Motorcycle Museum, and we'll see some nice old British iron and see how you like that.
Nice one. Let's go.
Okay.
I'd love to hop on the back, Dave, but I don't think it's
going to
be possible, is it?
Yeah, there's not much room, that's the bit. I haven't got a seat there, so
yeah,
I guess I'll see you up there.
Yeah, see at the Harley shop in Watford.
Okay.
All right.
I'll try not to get lost.
Right, Welcome back to Full Throttle Famous with me, Marianne Hobbs, and my very special guest, Dave Vanian. Well, I'm here with Stacey and with Paul, the owners of this exotic Harley-Davidson dealership in Watford. I'd like you both to meet Dave Vanian.
Hi, Dave. How can it be exotic in Watford?
Well, you seem to have accomplished it.
Hello there, Sid. Right.
How are you?
Yeah. Now, he's the proud owner of this absolutely beautiful 1940s Harley-Davidson. What do you make of this machine?
Gorgeous. That's what it's all about. It's the real essence of Harley. And you can see this from this bike, straight through to our modern bikes, that everything that's captured in this is in the new bikes, and there's a direct link between this and something like the Springer.
Absolutely.
First impressions, the bike is gorgeous. When I started with Harley about 10 years ago, this is exactly what I pictured Harley should be like, and it's quite strange that the modern day bike, which we've literally just had delivered a few days ago, a brand new version of this has just come out, and I wouldn't say it's identical, but it is identical. You know, okay, there's modern day technology gone into it, but it's just astounding how close it is in relation to this one.
All day we've been watching grown men weep looking at this vehicle. I mean, have you got absolutely anything that would compare to it that you can show us today here?
The new V-Rod. This has been around now since 2002 and is as far away from that as you can possibly get, yet it still has the same genes. It's still a Harley Davidson. It's just a much more modern. It's Harley Davidson brought up to date. And then we've also got something else for the sports bike riders. You've got something called the Buell, which is an American sports bike, which I think you're going to have a play on later on.
Yeah, might have a little burn on it, yeah.
Totally different, yet they're still Harley. The essence is still a V-twin, slightly different configuration on this one. It's a 60-degree V-twin rather than a 90, but 45. But take them out for a spin, see what you think.
Yeah. Could you potentially be seduced by a vehicle like this, though, do you think, Dave? Or really, is it the old school aesthetic that really appeals to you a bit more?
I like the idea of this, I must admit. I think some of it I really like, and some of it looks a little bit too heavy for me. Mm. You know, I'd probably take this bike and slim it down a little bit, but make a lovely bobber.
Okay, gents, let's stick Dave on a new bike. What's it going to be today?
V-Rod, first of all.
I think so.
Yeah, take a V-Rod.
A whole different kettle of fish, this one. Absolutely smooth. It feels more like 100 years than 60 years away from my bike, that's for sure.
Oh, the view is gorgeous. You can just hear it
purring. Yeah, it's a bit like riding a fairground ride more than a bike. Two bikes together look totally different. I mean, that Buell is sitting way high up, and it looks like it should be on a racing circuit. How's that feel?
It's great, it's lovely.
How's that?
You'd really enjoy it, I'm sure. Uh-huh. It's really slick, it's lovely. God, I tell you what, this is almost perfect, this ride out this afternoon. It's lovely, it's a perfect six bike, this.
Marianne, what did you think?
To be honest, I'm going to be gutted to have to leave this place without it. I'm absolutely in love with it. It's fantastic. It's so smooth, so easy to ride. I love the fact that it's so compact. It's a perfect chick's bike. And, you know, I hope it does a great deal for me in the aesthetic department as well. I mean, as a girl, you pick a bike in exactly the same way as you pick a pair of shoes, you know what I mean? Call me shallow, but that's just the way that it is.
None of the Buells have been referred to as like a stiletto.
Oh, it's amazing. Loved it. Absolutely loved it.
Oh, please.
Hi. What do you
think
of
the V-Rod?
Well, you know, when you first get on it, especially after being on that machine, that's so archaic. This is like getting on something from the future almost. It just zooms along.
How did you get on with the stretch to the foot pegs?
That was just a bit too much for me because I'm a bit of a short arse, so... Yeah.
you know, brought up a couple of inches, that would be very comfortable.
Well, that's fine.
Yeah. And the one thing I noticed about it as well is that it goes around corners like it's on rails. You know, you don't need to steer it. You just kind of lean a little bit here and have your knees.
Did you appreciate the smoothness in comparison to yours? Or?
Oh, yeah. I mean, it's obviously a completely different animal.
Of course.
But
I sincerely hope so.
I must admit, it's very interesting. I enjoyed it.
Bigger,
I know, it seems enormous. It's like sitting on the roof of a Mini. But we'll see. Oh yeah, no, this is a totally different ride. It's like a big comfortable armchair. Typical Harley grunt. But underway, it feels really light for such a big machine. And of course, incredibly comfortable.
It's quite powerful. To actually do this bike real justice, I would need to grow a beard and cultivate a hairy back.
Yeah, I must admit, I'm starting to enjoy this. Yeah, it's not until you really stop you realise how big this thing is. I was getting into neutral, a little bit of a trial.
So Dave, an exquisite choice of bikes today for you to try out. Which one did you prefer?
Well, it's a hard choice, you know, because I didn't expect to like both of them. The actual riding experience was great on both. This one, you could feel, you know, it wanted to go. If I wanted to go on the motorway with that, I'd take that for a lot of fun, you know. But that one, I expected to be unwieldy big, because, you know, I'm not a big fella. Absolutely marvellous to ride. Most comfortable thing I think I've ever ridden, but.
And it's beautifully balanced, isn't it?
Yeah, beautifully balanced. And a lot of power there, a lot of low-end grunt. It's a fantastic ride, I must admit. I mean, that I could see why someone would go across Europe touring with that, because it's just perfect for it, isn't it, or whatever.
Marianne, which was your favourite?
Oh, do you know what? No contest for me. I've got to go for the Buell, it has to be said. The Sportster was nice, but the Buell's got everything I possibly needed. Absolutely tricked, totally gorgeous girl's bike. No contest.
We've had a great time with these Harley Davidsons here. But where we're going to go now, you're going to meet this guy who's just probably eats grease for breakfast, you know. He's a Triumph man through and through with his museum, the London Motorcycle Museum. And Bill's Triumphs, it's real British iron, so I get to see that next.
Yeah.
See what you think of that.
Come on, let's do it. Dave, I know that this is your idea of paradise, but it looks quite inconspicuous, this place. Tell me where we are.
Well, it's totally hidden away. We're just in the back of the wilds of Greenford here. This is Bill.
Hi, Bill.
It's Marianne.
Very nice to meet you.
He's a Triumph man through and through, and he's the man responsible for this great place.
Oh, great. Come on, let's go and have a look inside.
Great.
Bill, I have to say, what an astonishing collection of motorcycles you have in here. Tell us a bit about the history of the museum. Where did this all begin for you?
It began a very long time ago, something like 40 years when I started collecting. But this museum has been open 6 years. It's the London Motorcycle Museum of British Bikes.
Now, I know Dave, he's probably salivating at every single one of these motorcycles, but if you had to pick, I don't know, say three, shows you top three in this building, what would it
be? That's a really difficult choice, because there are some amazing machines in here. But let's have a walk down the bottom and have a look. There's this Coventry Eagle. That's absolutely amazing. What's the story behind this one, Bill?
It's all original. It hasn't been restored or anything. All the parts are as it came out the factory.
That's amazing. What year is that? 30?
It's 25.
25?
Yeah.
Wow.
It's a 980cc Flying 8, they call it.
And let's see, and it would have to be a Triumph as well. It would have to be Tiger 100, because I just love the Turner styling of these, you know. as well.
It was great. That style lasted quite a few years, in actual fact.
Yeah.
Everybody loved it, using a lot of films.
Yeah.
So one more bike, Dave, what's it going to be?
One more bike. It's definitely this Triumph up the top.
Okay.
This bike's very special because it's a prototype. And yeah, tell us about this one, because it's got a good story.
1965, it's called a P1. It's the first Triumph Trident made by Mirrodin Factory Triumph.
Right.
They produced it, tried it up and down the motorway, had lots of failures with it, with primary drive seizing up, etc. It boiled the oil, it had lots of problems. But it also did 124 mile an hour up and down the motorway.
That was in 1965.
In 1965, that's fast.
I guess every single one of these bikes must feel like one of your own children, doesn't it, Bill?
Every bike's got a story.
Yeah.
Most Sundays, I try not to because we have other work to get on with, but we stand here for hours just going through the same story. But different people, especially our foreign visitors who come around there, they all want to know about them.
Yeah. That's brilliant. So Dave, almost impossible to choose a favourite bike in
totally
a place like this, really.
Yeah. Take a lot.
What about today then? Are you going to stick with your beautiful vintage bike? Would you go for a new Harley? Or if you could, in an ideal world, cart off one of these bikes, what would it have to be?
If I had the choice, and some money, I have to say, sorry to the Harley boys, but I would still go for an old British bike.
Vintage through and through then?
Yeah, I think so. Yeah. Although, I love the rides on those modern bikes was fantastic and everything, but still you can't. I don't know why we do it, but it's a challenge getting somewhere on an old bike. It's just like nothing else, you know.
Well, listen, it's been an absolute pleasure.
Yeah,
thank you so much.
You.
Yeah.
Thanks. And thanks, Bill, for showing us around the museum.
Yeah,
and people come to this museum, spend your money, and have a good day out and a nice breakfast on Sunday.
Nice. Tell you what, I really thought we might be able to seduce Dave when we took him over to that Harley shop with all those beautiful, gleaming new machines surrounding him. But you take him to a place like this, it's game over. You're never going to be able to kick the vintage out of that boy.